Here, the problem of farmers was, the varying year, two seasons. One is lean and another is flush. In flush season, people were suffering for selling the milk. But a company, people like this come into sector, setting up processing facilities. We are able to procure the milk, whatever produced by the farmer, and able to market successfully relative to prices. But the main issue, what dairying I see in southern states and also in other developing states, is that primarily productivity of the animals. If you see, India possesses about 25% of the livestock population of the world, but the productivity is one of the lowest in the world. That is Bihar, Rajasthan, UP, and milk was going as far as states like Gujarat. But now, more than 50 to 60% milk is being produced in Bengal itself. We don't mind because it is turning to be a producer state as against a consumer state area. But definitely, what we have to look at is farmers' aptitude to dairying whenever we want to venture into it. Aptitude of the farmers is very important for the day. And another constraint what we have been facing is on productivity and quality of the produce and how it's handled. You know, India is going to be the supplier for the dairy products to the world very soon. But today, our products are not accepted because of quality parameters. The quality in terms of production practices, quality in terms of handling practices, quality in terms of processing facilities have to substantially improve them. I feel this industry, this business will give much more higher return to farmer than any other agricultural activity. I'm very confident about it. Thank you.
Great story. If we can request Bjorn Whittle to give his views, Desai Fruits and Vegetables has shown that you can produce in India for export. And your comments on how you did that and what were the issues, both on the capacity building and the financing side, would be very useful. And also, I think Mr. Rao hinted at one issue is standard setting. In terms of fruits and vegetables industry, for example, there are no standards. Internationally, there are standards. IFC is working with JN Irrigation to set up an Indian GAP standard, which could become an industry norm. But without that, it would be difficult for fruits and vegetables exporters to export to European countries. But here's a success story, and I'd really like you to share that with
them. Thank you very much. So these are fruits and vegetables today. I believe we have built a partnership farming organization in India with small farmers, which is unparalleled. We are coming from the markets, so our clients request consistency in quality and volume. So we looked at India and found its very fundamental advantages of proximity to our key markets of fresh produce in the Middle East, but also today we're also exporting to Ukraine, to other markets in Europe as the only company in banana. And we said, okay, if the market demands this fresh fruit, how do we do this in India? Because what nature has given you in terms of soil and sun and the sun belt and everything, it's phenomenal. It rains, but it only rains once. So you have a potential advantage of disease control and all these technical factors. So we came together with a farmer in Gujarat, very advanced farmer, Mr. Ajit Desai, the founder and CMD of the company. Who is a grassroots farmer, has been very innovative. He was the first one to introduce drip irrigation to Gujarat in the 80s even. So he really knows the real problem at grassroots level. And that's the essence of our business still today. It's really knowing what the farmers need to know. Then what we looked at is it's bringing technology to India. And it's not about knowledge itself, because most of what we do is really known in books from the 1960s. It's really about implementation and getting this into an Indian context. And then with this implementing, really driving and educating the farmers to get this quality, which then is being paid a higher price in the international markets. And if we go directly, then we can get back more to the farmers. That's a very simple logic. So before we came, an average farmer in our region, Gujarat, was doing two crops in 3 years, two banana crops in 3 years. Today, they're doing five crops in 3 years on the same piece of land. In addition, the average weight of the banana bunch went up significantly, at least by 5 kgs. So there's a clear link to the farm and a clear benefit. And I'm not the one to speak to farmers and convince them whatever they do. It's only farmers convincing farmers. And that's the only way to go. So we started very small on less than 80 acres. And since 4 or 5 years, we've been doubling our volumes every year, in the beginning even tripling. So in 9-10, we did over 20,000 metric tons of banana this year. Last financial year, we did over 40,000 metric tons. And we're going to scale up to 300,000 metric tons in 2014. The market feedback which we're getting as we have applied a lot of technology is very positive. So I would say by far, you know, supplying a couple of hundred containers to a single client without a quality claim to certain markets in the Middle East is something which is very, very, it shows proof of concept that it can work with small farmers. So the concept of volume aggregation and really educating the farmers on the ground by bringing in a lot of technology in a way, but implementation and standardization, and that's the key for scalability, and I'm not scared at all to multiply in that direction, because you can de-risk the business just by going to different geographies, and the same farmers now from, we started in Maharashtra, we invited them 2 years ago to come over to Gujarat, so we started in Maharashtra, we shipped our first containers from Tamil Nadu now, so we're really building and de-risking our business across India from a production side, and the same also on a seasonal aspect, and from a market side, of course, by having that technology, also you can have consistency in quality and volume to cater even to European markets.
Do you engage in contracts with the farmers?
Yes, we have what we call partnership farming model, so we pay them. We have a standard A to Z, a standard operating procedures. We educate the farmers, we sign a contract with them, tell them end to end what to do, and teach them every day on the fields. We have over 300 educated people, agronomists, to do that. And we pay them for quality and incentive. So there's a clear base price where they can live off. We have a certain incentive, and like the tissue companies who supply our farmers know that if they're associated with us, they would give them a credit. We support them, so it's a whole set of things we do for the farmer, which is connected to that contract. So it's a long-term contract, a guaranteed income, if he follows our standards, where we help him with, and he gets a very clear incentive for quality.
Yeah, I personally love contracts because I think for the farmer, it de-risks a lot. And I think that's what milk purchase through Milk Revolution has done, and so does this model. But tell me, through this process, has capacities of farmers increased, or are you actually leveraging on the traditional wisdom, the knowledge that farmers had?
I think the base is the level of information the farmers have and education. It's very hard to change, so taking really a step-by-step approach, there's nothing you can just change across. But we have a lot of very young farmers with us, and they're very eager to learn. And they really see a great potential by being part of our model, by not having to move to cities, and it's a real benefit for them to stay in their social environment and earn good money out of it. So that's a clear way to also lift the education level. We founded a PPP with the German Technology Corporation, with the GDZ. We founded the Desai Agriculture Academy. Basically, we have two models in there. We have a good agricultural practice training, where we have a lot of like really hands-on, you know, a little bit of education, but really hands-on how to irrigate. That's really basics across all crops. And then we have commodity-specific, where we bring in international experts from the banana world to teach our farmers also on commodities, in our case, bananas, but we would like to expand that later also to other commodities.
So, we're very conscious that we stand between you and lunch, and that's a dangerous position to be in. I know that there was some time taken due to technical reasons, but at this stage, you know, the idea is for us to engage with you and for you to engage with yourselves. Some issues I think we still need to flag is the peculiarity of this particular sector. That's the risk, and Hemant has quite outlined the big market. But for financier, how do you access that market in terms of the risks? So issues talking that one should talk about really is sort of weather-based risk insurance, information about the weather. We spoke about infrastructure and warehousing. Warehousing financing has worked very mixed proportions, I would say. IFC is looking at both these areas, but that's an issue we'd like to really table. Because unless the farmer has a holding period, where they can put their goods in a warehouse, get a financing for it, and sell at the right time, there will always be under pressure to sell at a lower price. But these are the topics we can explore together. So I think if you all agree, we'd like to open up the floor and for question and answers or comments.
Hello, my name is Ravindra Kumar. I grow mangoes in UP. I manufacture small tractors in Gujarat and in Haryana. I am now investing into cashmere goods in Ladakh. And I also manufacture silk and cashmere textiles which are exported under our own branding all over the world. Question for you. I'm sorry, Mr. Pion, I don't get your family name. Is your interest only in bananas, or does it extend beyond bananas to other fruits like lychees and mangoes, which I happen to grow? And my family grows these fruits on about 500 acres. So that's a question for you. And for the gentleman next to you, with respect to financing, converting agricultural produce into a marketable product. This is something that's been going on forever. I mean, sugar mills buy sugar cane and transform it into sugar and it's sold. So there is really nothing spectacular about converting agricultural produce into a product which has a shelf life and selling it. But in terms of aggregation, with my gray hair and 35 years of being in business, there's this spectacular deficit of rural infrastructure. Somebody who's working on an H-1 visa in the U.S. in a software sweatshop can sell a blanket for his mother, all right, in Bihar. Now, DHL will take it all the way up to Patna or Begusarai or whatever it is. But beyond Begusarai, to a little village called Ulao, there is no connectivity. Further, there is no connectivity from Begusarai for any produce, from Ulao to Begusarai, or from Ulao to another village. So this is something that I want to focus on, that the transportation and access from village to village and from village to a block of water that they see, where the entire connectivity, the transportation logistic connectivity ends. That is an area which, unless it is looked at and invested into, will remain a problem. Nobody in a village has any way of selling 250 kilos of bhindi that he grows on his half acre plot. He doesn't know how to sell it. I mean, there's no way he can receive money for it, and if he takes it in a tractor, it costs him 1500 rupees for 15 kilometers. So this village to village and village to town connectivity is a major thing. Thanks.
Do you want to comment first, and I do on bananas?
I fully agree with you, and I fully appreciate, for an entrepreneur, it's a big challenge. If he has to invest money, should he invest in his business model, or should he build a back end or a front end for that? It's usually a dilemma, and I fully agree that if you're a third party service provider, you mentioned DHL. We have seen many DHLs coming in India. Somebody having warehouses, somebody having cold chains, but they're limited to a region or a geography.